Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we'll discuss some MCQ and SCQ on thyroid and parathyroid glands. How to attempt the different patterns of the MCQ which are given, and how one MCQ can be given as an SCQ, or it can be given in OSPI examination. First of all, the 8 months old baby was brought to pediatric OPD for her poor feeding and delayed growth problem. What can be the most probable diagnosis? Options over here are mixed edema, secondary hypothyroidism, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, cretinism, nephrotic syndrome. By seeing the picture, it is very clear. The key point over here is the poor feeding and the delayed growth. These are the features. This mixed edema is not matchable with the age. Secondary hypothyroidism is not the cause over here. And then Hashimoto's thyroiditis is not the picture in this scenario. Any key point is not given. Cretinism is one of the options which match with the condition and by seeing the picture. If the picture is not given, even then it should be cretinism. In nephrotic syndrome, although a child may look like this, number one. Number two, secondly, no finding of the proteinuria has been given in this particular statement. So the best option will be cretinism. A 53-year-old male saw his general practitioner because of bone pain and constipation. A number of the laboratory tests were requested. The results for the most relevant of which are as follows. Corrected calcium 11.8. Phosphate 2.9, it is hypophosphatemia. Then PTH level, it's 208. Normal level is 20-65. Here it is hypercalcemia. In the previous lecture, it has been mentioned the corrected level is total corrected calcium level is more important than the total uncorrected level. So it is definitely hypercalcemia. The most pertinent explanation for these findings would be appropriate increase in PTH level. It is not inappropriate. Hypercalcemia with inappropriate levels due to an adenoma. Then it is patient has Mill-Culkley syndrome, which is totally irrelevant to this scenario. Secondary hyperparathyroidism is no clue over there. And there is no adrenal insufficiency relevance over here. The appropriate answer will be then, it by seeing these values, it's inappropriate hypercalcemia with inappropriate levels due to an adenoma. This would be the most appropriate answer for this one. Then a 43 years old woman has had increasing lethargy and weakness over past 3 years. She has difficulty in concentrating and her memory is poor. She has chronic constipation. On physical examination, temperature is 35, pulse 54, respiratory 13 per minute, BP 110 by 70. She has alopecia and her skin appear coarse and dry. Her face, hands and feet appear puffy. This is the clear-cut scenario and what can it can be. Now, what are the key points over here? That is concentration loss and then the memory is poor. Secondly, moreover, the alopecia and skin appear coarse and dry. These are the typical features, and particularly the feet appear and hands appear puffy. Here it has been asked, what is the most probable diagnosis? What can be done? There are two ways of asking the question. One, this can be in the SCQ. Which test you will advise for confirmation? If this is the scenario, and then the diagnosis will be, if we go over there, the second option of this question can be, which of the following serological test findings is most likely to be positive in this woman? If you are clear about that it is hypothyroidism, and what test you will for the confirmation, the answer is then here anti-TPO. Okay, it can be asked in this way and it can be asked by this one. Here you have to write only this one. So you keep in mind the scenarios can be used for the SCQ or for the MCQ, but it is your own availability of application of the mind that you see the key points and go to the diagnosis. Then next, a 2-year-old child has failure to thrive since infancy. Physical examination shows that the child is short and has coarse facial features, protruding tongue, and an umbilical hernia. As the child matures, profound intellectual disability becomes apparent, deficiency of which of the following hormones is most likely to explain these findings. These are all the findings which has been thus in the other scenario in first question, in which the picture was shown, and that was a scenario of the cretinism. All these are the findings of cretinism, but here it has been asked in the other way. No role of cortisol, insulin, nor epinephrine, but it is only the thyroxine. Here he has given the hormones. If the conditions would have been given, then it would have been cretinism over here, and some other conditions which are more likely, like having the same features. So one question can be asked in this way, and in the first question it was asked in the other way. Now, next question. A 38 years old woman felt a small bump on the right side of her neck 1 month ago. It has not changed since then. Physical examination shows a 1 centimeter painless nodule palpable in the right lower pole of the thyroid gland. There is no lymphoid adenopathy. Radionuclide scanning shows the nodule does not absorb the radioactive iodine and no other nodules are present. Fine needle aspiration biopsy of the nodule is done, and cytological features are those of the follicular neoplasm. Which of the following laboratory findings is most likely to be present in this patient? Diagnosis has been given and there should not be any difficulty in anti-TSH receptor immunoglobulins. They are present in Graves' disease. High free T4 cannot be over there, because in this follicular neoplasm, the thyroid profile parameters are not disturbed. So the normal TSH is the best option. And the anti-TPO is more towards the myxedema. The next question is, which one of the following most frequently the cause of the hypercalcemia in patients with malignant disease? So when you have gone through the hypercalcemia, you must have seen, apart from the parathyroid causes, that there are other causes of hypercalcemia. But in this, calcitonin, calcitriol, parathyroid hormone related peptide, tumor necrosis factor alpha. But here problem is with the malignant disease. In this, there is release of the PTH, which is PTH related peptides, which are in quite a large number, and they are present in this malignancy and causing the hypercalcemia. A 54 years male admitted in the hospital for last 1 week. He has been operated for some chronic problem. Most common cause of the hypercalcemia in hospitalized patients. Now again, it has been asked in some other way. Scenario is the same, answer is the same. Here, hyperparathyroidism, chronic problem, admission is there for the last 1 week, and malignancy, then multiple myeloma, sarcoidosis. These are all chronic conditions. Patient can be admitted, but no other clue has been given regarding these conditions. So clue must be kept in mind in the statement. Here again, the answer is malignancy. Purpose of giving such questions to just to familiarize, one question may be asked in another way, the answer would be the same, but the scenario may be different. Which investigations will help in diagnosing a case of hyperparathyroidism? Now, you must be remembering in the lectures we have discussed what are the investigations which are important. Serum calcium corrected on repeat testing, which is important. Then serum phosphate. Calcium and phosphorus are the two important parameters for this one, along with the PTH, which is also very much necessary for documentation of the hyperparathyroidism. Then renal function to just assess the renal capacity and urea and creatinine are measured. Then ESR, serum protein and electrophoresis to rule out the myeloma. Then because in this condition, particularly the calcium will be high, and then in multiple myeloma, hypercalcemia is also found. Then alkaline phosphatase is also documented. It is more, usually more than two times the normal limit. Then thyroid function tests to rule out hyperthyroidism as cause of the hypercalcemia, in which it is present. In some cases, it may be present hypercalcemia. So these are the investigations which will help in diagnosis of the hyperparathyroidism. A 37 years old woman has had difficulty swallowing and a feeling of fullness in anterior neck for the past week. On physical examination, her temperature is 37, pulse 74, respiration 16, and blood pressure is 122/80. Palpation of her diffusely enlarged thyroid elicits pain. Laboratory studies show an increased serum T4 level and a decreased TSH level. T3 level is now normal. She gives history of mild upper respiratory tract infection 1 month ago. If you have, now question is, what is the most probable diagnosis? In this particular question, there are multiple key features which have been given. First is the thyroid elicits pain. Second is your serum increased T4 and decreased TSH level. And T3 is normal. History of the mild upper respiratory tract infection. If we go towards thyroiditis, then which type of the thyroiditis elicits pain, which is the painful? Then the answer is subacute granulomatous thyroiditis. Hashimoto's is not that type of the thyroiditis in which there is pain. So it must be kept in mind. The scenario must be read properly. The key points you will find definitely in that to reject the diagnosis. A 42 years old female consult physician for her tremors, weight loss and anxiety. On examination, her eyeballs are protruding and her skin is red and swollen over the shins. Which single lab test will be most appropriate for the diagnosis? Now, here you can see, if this picture is not given, this is clearly bulging out, and if you see the patient, it is the clear-cut picture of the exophthalmos. What can be the single test? That is the TSH, most sensitive test. Here, TSH receptor antibody is also part of it, but most suitable, most appropriate will be this one, because here we have to diagnose, or diagnosis is asked for the diagnosis. So it is a case of the Graves' disease. Now, concentrate on this one. A 45 years old man presents with swelling in the anterior portion of his neck. Physical examination reveals enlarged nodular thyroid. Thyroid function tests are within normal limits. A thyroid CT scan shows dominant hot nodule. Biopsy reveals neoplastic cells with evidence of the vascular and capsular invasion. And there are metastases on the X-ray examination. What is the most likely diagnosis? One is anaplastic, B-cell lymphoma, follicular carcinoma, medullary carcinoma, metastatic carcinoma. Here, all the pictures are going towards this one, follicular carcinoma. Here, it is the metastasis, and other things should be kept. The thyroid scan, biopsy, neoplastic cells, evidence, vascular and the capsular invasion, which are the features of a follicular carcinoma. Now, this scenario, keep in mind, now it is 45 years old man presenting with that swelling anterior, same question, what is the most likely diagnosis? Name two other malignant thyroid cancer. Here, it has been asked, the diagnosis is the same, scenario is the same, but picture is given as in the, it may be given in the OSPIC. The most likely diagnosis is the follicular thyroid carcinoma. What two other malignant conditions thyroid conditions, cancers can be there. This is not in the differential, but it has been asked separately. Papillary carcinoma and medullary carcinoma, these are the few things which you can write down over here. So purpose of this scenario, repeating again with this picture, is the same to highlight you that you must keep in mind one question may be asked in two ways to get the answers. Then next question is, a 33 years old woman presents with a swelling in her neck, which she felt or noticed 2 months ago, reveals a solitary non-tender nodule of the thyroid gland measuring 2 centimeters in diameter. Thyroid function tests are within normal limits. Nodule does not accumulate iodine on thyroid scan. Biopsy of the nodule is shown in the image. This is the biopsy, which is the, here it has been given. These are the cells and it is a picture of a follicular adenoma. Write down the 2 features of this ligand. Now, follicular adenoma is encapsulated neoplasm in which the cells are arranged in follicles resembling the normal thyroid tissue. It is a benign disorder. It is well circumscribed, and thyroid nodule in young patient most likely represents a follicular adenoma. Then comes the next question. 39 years old female presented with a large painless swelling in her neck. Because all the questions will be regarding either neoplasm, either benign neoplasm or malignant, or regarding the thyroiditis, or two more conditions like Graves' disease and hypothyroidism or mixed edema. These are the common conditions which will be asked in the questions. She had some features of the hypothyroidism. Her thyroid has symmetric diffuse enlargement. Her report revealed anti-TPO and anti-thyroglobulin antibodies. Now, clear-cut evidence has been given. These are the 3 questions which has been asked. Write down 3 histomorphological features seen in this condition. 3rd question is, what changes can be expected in her thyroid profile? Now, if you look at this one, painless swelling in her neck, features of hypothyroidism, anti-TPO is positive, anti-thyroglobulin is also positive. Clear-cut diagnosis is Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Now, 3 histomorphological features seen in this condition. Diffusely and symmetrically enlarged on gross examination. Capsule enlarged, intact capsule, gland is well demarcated. Cut surface shows pale gray, tan, firm, friable picture. On microscopic examination, the infiltration of the lymphocytes and the plasma cells, well-developed germinal centers, and Herthel cell is the key feature of this condition. So keep in mind that when the scenario is like this, it is asked in the SCQ, and you have to write, it will be just carrying weightage of 1 mark or 2 mark, and 2 marks, you have to write all these findings over. What changes? The 3rd part was, what changes can be expected in thyroid profile? It is Hashimoto's. In initial phase, there will be features of the hyperthyroidism. These will be raised and this will be decreased. But in the later stages, it will be picture of the hypothyroidism. The TSH will be increased and T3, T4 will be decreased. So these are the questions which are discussed just to make you familiarize with the different types of the questions which are asked and may be useful. Thank you very much. Okay.